Poor email deliverability could be costing your business hundreds of thousands of dollars, and you may not even know it. So in the past, I've talked about how a lot of times people have, they're suffering from low email deliverability, or maybe it's kind of in the mid-range and they don't even realize what's happening. So they don't know that a lot of their emails are ending up in the spam folder for a lot of recipients because they still have a decent portion of people who are receiving the emails and continuing to engage and purchase. And what's happened is over time, the revenue has slid down at a slow rate. They didn't really notice that that was the cause of what was happening. And I've seen this happen a bunch of times with clients that we've worked with where their email list was mismanaged by whoever was managing it before. And they didn't realize how much potential revenue they were missing out on until we actually did some work to fix their email deliverability. And this is one of those cases where, depending on how bad it is, a lot of times you have to take one step back to be able to take two steps forward. So I'll give you an example. So a client that we recently started working with, this was one of those cases where it was very obvious that they were dealing with some email deliverability issues because their engagement rates had plummeted. They were getting open rates that were around like 10%, and they used to get, you know, 30, 40% every time. And their email revenue, the monthly revenue, had dwindled down to less than a few thousand dollars per month. So this was a major problem. And so what we had to do was we had to go through a lot of the steps I'm going to share with you in this video, but also we had to take a little bit of downtime from sending. We went a couple of weeks without really sending much at all. And then we slowly ramped it up over the next 2 to 4 weeks after that. And by doing so, we were able to completely reverse the damage with their email deliverability. We were able to get them a good sender reputation score and also take their monthly email revenue from less than a few thousand to well over 30,000 and continuing to grow at this point. And all of this happened, we were able to do this in about 60 days. So this is something that, again, can be very valuable for your business, especially if you don't realize that you're having some issues. So if you're watching this at the time of me uploading it, then you've probably seen a lot of these announcements in early 2024 about the new Google rules for bulk senders. So I'm not going to go into detail on that. You can just Google it. There's a you know, hundreds of free guides online that break down what that is. But because of that, email deliverability is finally starting to get some of the attention it deserves, but I think it's still widely misunderstood. So I want to break it down really quickly, but more importantly, I want to go over some things that you can do to improve your email deliverability and ideally just prevent these issues from happening in the first place. So really quickly, email deliverability is just a term that refers to the likelihood of your emails landing in the inbox of your recipients. And your email deliverability is determined by your sender reputation, your content quality, your subscriber engagement, list hygiene, the technical configuration of your domain, and spam complaints. So let's start from the beginning and go over what you can do to either fix your deliverability or just prevent having deliverability issues in the first place. So the first thing is the technical configuration. So you want to make sure you've got all of your tech set up correctly. And so what this means is if you're a bulk sender, you need to have a dedicated sending domain. You need to make sure you're sending from an email address that matches the parent domain. So if you were, you know, if you set up a dedicated sending domain that was, you know, email.dogs.com, you need to be sending from an email that could be something like info@dogs.com, right? So it needs to match. And then of course you want to have DMARC, DKIM, you want to have all of these other DNS records set up. And I'm not going to go into detail on that because there's tons of free tools out there you can use to get that set up. So what I would recommend is go to a website called easydmarc.com. And I have no affiliation with this website, but it's just a really useful website for getting your DNS records set up. So what you can do is you can put in your domain, you can do a quick audit of your domain to make sure you have the necessary DNS records, and then make the changes based on the suggestions on that site. There's a bunch of other free tools like that. That's just one that I like to use. So that's the first thing, is you want to make sure you've got everything set up from a technical standpoint correctly, because that's going to cause issues before we even get into anything to do with your list and your content and all of that. So then the next step from there, if we're going to reverse engineer this, is I would say you want to first start by building a quality list. Now, it might be too late for you, and then you're going to have to start kind of weeding out some of these bad leads. But if you are fortunate enough to be starting with this information from the beginning, then it's good to know that you should be thoughtful about how you're building your list. So you want to make sure that, first of all, that people know they're opting in to receive email marketing. You don't want to do any kind of, tricky things where you get people to, where you're basically tricking them into signing up, but you're not making it explicitly clear that they are going to be receiving email marketing, because you're just going to have a lot of annoyed subscribers who click spam and don't engage with the emails. And those people aren't going to buy anyways. So it's going to do more harm than good. So this thought that the bigger the list, the better, is not necessarily the case. It's really more about quality over quantity, and ideally quality and quantity. So if you're having it, let's just say you are making it clear that they are signing up for email marketing, but you're still getting a lot of, let's say, emails that are bouncing, or just, you know, getting a lot of people signing up who aren't engaging. One thing you can do is, if you haven't done so already, is to turn on double opt-in. So that way they have to confirm with that confirmation email. So a lot of times us email marketers, we like to have single opt-in because it gets people in quicker. We can get them into that first email if they've signed up for some sort of offer and get that offer right away. We have less friction between them and the offer and then making the purchase. But again, if you're having issues with the quality of leads that are joining your list, then consider using double opt-in. Then another thing is, definitely don't buy email lists. As tempting as that can be, people think that, oh, this list is really targeted because there's, you know, people from this industry, or they came from this company or whatever. I can tell you, I've seen it time and time again. Just because those people were targeted for the original business that built that list does not mean that that's going to actually translate to interest in your business. Because again, people don't like to get emails from sites, businesses, people, whatever, that they didn't sign up for. So don't buy lists. Another thing that's really common is a lot of brands will participate in these big social media giveaways with other brands. And a lot of times this ends up creating a big list of leads who have signed up for this giveaway. And then everyone shares that list, all the brands who participated, they share that list with each other. And this is a great way to build up a big list, but it's not a great way of building up a high quality list. I've seen this be very hit or miss. Sometimes the people from these giveaways, they do buy and they do engage and they stay engaged on the email list. But more often than not, I see very low engagement from those people and very low conversions. So it's something where you want to be thoughtful about how you bring them in. So whenever you add them to your list, be sure to keep them on a separate list from your main list and put them into some sort of flow that is going to nurture them and try to get them to make a purchase. And then the people who are really engaged and the people who make a purchase, I would go ahead and bring them over to your main list, and all the others who don't, I would just keep them separated. And you could even just remove those profiles or suppress them if they don't engage, because again, it's just going to be weighing you down with a bunch of dead leads. So that's the first thing, is just building a high quality list, just being thoughtful. You want to make sure that you're building a list of people who have some sort of buying intent. And again, this is why with e-commerce brands, I'm not a big fan of doing a lot of the typical free lead magnet type of offers to build your list, like you would do with service businesses or info product businesses and things like that. Now, they can work. It just depends, but you want to be more thoughtful about it. A lot of times having some sort of offer that they opt into, whether it's a coupon code for a discount, free shipping, a free gift with purchase, something that's tied to the purchase where they know upfront that if I sign up for this thing, the only way I get this thing is if I make a purchase, those people have a higher buying intent. And that tends to work better for e-com. Whereas the people who are trying to get some sort of free lead magnet, those people who sign up for, you know, like info product businesses, now those people might actually have buying intent, but maybe they need to learn something. And maybe if you're selling information, then it's going to be easier to keep them engaged on your email list and eventually convert them into being a client or a customer by continuing to teach them things. But that's not always that's not typically going to work as well with e-com, because yes, you do want to provide product education and things like that, but it's usually not as much education based. And it's, you know, like the way for them to get the solution they're looking for is they need to buy the product. There's not like, you know, teaching them is not going to replace them not having the product, right? So, so that's building your list. Now, if we go a little bit further down the line, the next thing is you want to make sure you're maintaining high engagement with the people on your list. So one of the easiest things you can do to start maintaining higher engagement is to do regular A/B testing on all of your automated emails and on your campaigns. So again, you're just only using content that people are engaging with the most and giving yourself the best chance of creating emails that people actually want to receive and making sure that people are actually opening and clicking these emails so that way you maintain a high engagement score. And then another thing is, I talk about this all the time, but it's always worth repeating, is to use segmentation. So you don't want to be emailing whenever you send campaigns. You don't want to be sending that email to everyone on your list. You want to create different segments and then create the content in a way that's going to cater and speak to that specific segment. And because that those emails are going to be more targeted, it's going to be more interesting for people, and you're a lot more likely to get good engagement with those emails. Another thing you can do, which I haven't really seen people talk about as much, but something that we do a lot of, is adding filters to your flows that filter out people who don't engage. So for a great, you know, example of how to do this is, let's say you have a welcome series flow, and you know, maybe it's a longer flow. Maybe you've got 6-10 emails, something like that. So let's say after email 4, or after email 6, you can put in, well, there's a couple of ways you can do it. So you can add flow filters in Klaviyo, or you can put in a little conditional split in the flow where if people haven't opened or haven't clicked an email in that flow prior to that point, that they get kicked out of the flow and they don't receive the future emails. So what this does is this makes sure that you're only sending emails to people who are actually interested and engaged. And that helps you maintain a much higher engagement score with your emails if you're using these filters strategically throughout your flows. And then the last thing I want to mention here is cleaning your list. So in Klaviyo, you can set up a flow called Sunset Unengaged, and they have a whole guide on their site that explains how to do this. And there's a bunch of resources online, so I'm not going to go into detail here. But what this does is, this is a flow that helps you tag people who have stopped engaging with your emails, so that way then you can go and manually suppress those contact profiles in your Klaviyo account. So you haven't deleted them, so you still have the past customer data and all of that, but you're preventing them from receiving emails from you. And you also don't have to pay for those profiles anymore as part of your monthly bill. So it saves you some money. So that's really important for list hygiene. It's just making sure that you're doing this on a regular basis. And because, again, it's not about having as many people as you can possibly get on your list. It's about having as many engaged people as you can possibly have on your list. So list hygiene is very important. So then the last thing I want to talk about here is sending quality content. And this is, I would say, it's a little bit more common sense, but maybe not. I think a lot of times if people have a background from social media, they might think that, you know, using a lot of clickbait and exaggerated claims and doing things that would translate to getting a lot of views on social media is the same approach you should take with email. But it's definitely not the case, because with email, you get punished pretty severely if people just, you know, if they get tricked, basically, if they open the emails and don't engage, and then they get to where they won't even open them because they're not going to fall for the trick anymore, then that's going to really hurt your sender reputation. So you don't want to be using clickbaity subject lines just to kind of trick people into opening the email if the content in the email doesn't deliver on what you said in the subject line. Another thing is, you don't want to be making all kinds of crazy exaggerated claims and using lots of all caps text and using a bunch of exclamation points and doing a lot of these things that are just, like, you know, over the top dramatic with the copy in the emails, because again, it just looks spammy. And if it looks spammy, you're more likely to end up in the spam folder. So, and one way to, you know, see this, just a perfect example of this, is just go to your own spam folder, skim through the emails, and you'll notice they all have a distinct style that just looks spammy. And you want to avoid doing anything like that. You'll also find that there are going to be some emails in there that are not spammy, but, and there may be even from things that you've signed up for and would like to receive those emails, but those emails are in there. And that's because those businesses are not doing these other things. They're not maintaining good engagement. They're not maintaining good list hygiene. And so those emails that you actually want to receive are landing in your spam folder, which is a perfect example of what you don't want to happen. So then the last thing I'll say here on the content piece is that, again, you want to be thoughtful. You want to be sending high quality content to people, content that they're actually interested in. So one thing you can do is just study what's worked in the past for your your email list and just focus on the content that your list enjoys. Continue to double down on the things that they like. And if you send, you know, if you have a certain type of email, it just didn't resonate, then just don't do that type of email again. So it could be a certain offer. It could be the angle you took to talk about the products, whatever the case is. That's why we're always testing and continuing to do more of the stuff that works and to do less of the stuff that doesn't work. So that's it. I just wanted to make this a quick high level overview of what to be doing to maintain your email deliverability. Again, there's tons of free tools that you can use to audit your email list, or sorry, audit your domain to make sure that everything is set up from a technical standpoint. There's also a bunch of tools that usually aren't free, but you can send test emails and check your email content to see if it's likely to go to spam. One thing I found is a lot of times these tools are very sensitive, where they're very sensitive about having anything in there that there's so many words that are commonly used in emails that are technically on the spam list. You know, for example, if you were to mention a guarantee, you know, like a manufacturer's warranty or something on your product, a lot of times that comes off as spammy, but in real life, it doesn't actually make you end up in a spam folder. So again, I would not go too crazy with, you know, limiting yourself, as long as you're just not doing things in a spammy way. You're being, you, if you have a warranty or whatever, I wouldn't make all these grand claims about it, but you can still mention it, right? So again, you just don't want to do things that look like the typical spammy internet marketer types of emails. And this sounds like a lot, and it might sound like, you know, there's a lot of work. Really, it's not. Usually email deliverability issues can be corrected in a few weeks. It's not as huge of a deal as it's made out to be. It's just something that you got to take action on and fix it as soon as you can, because the longer you let it go, it will continue to get worse and worse. And you don't want to get to the point where you have to go set up a whole new domain and everything because you've just completely burned out your existing domain. So don't let that happen. So that's it for this email or this video. I'm always thinking about emails. I'll see you in the next video.